All right, so welcome everyone. Thank you so much for joining today's CSML seminar talk, especially given that the ICML deadline has passed 2 hours ago, and some of you might be a bit exhausted by now, but I'm very optimistic that this talk will help you to re-energize. We have the great pleasure of having Mihaela Schaar here, who will talk about why medicine is creating exciting new frontiers for machine learning. Mihaela is the John Humphrey Plummer Professor of Machine Learning, AI and Medicine at the University of Cambridge, a fellow at the Alan Turing Institute in London, and a Chancellor's Professor at the University of California, Los Angeles. Mihaela has received numerous academic awards and in 2019 has been identified by the National Endowment for Science, Technology and the Arts as the most cited female AI researcher in the UK. In fact, she has published more than 250 journal articles, several books and book chapters, and more than 275 conference papers. Her research expertise is very diverse, spanning signal and image processing, communication networks, network science, multimedia, game theory, distributed systems, and machine learning. Today, she will talk about her most recent research focus, machine learning for healthcare, and I'm thrilled to have her here today. Please welcome Mihaela.
Thank you very much, Jan, for the kind presentation, and thank you all for joining. It's such a pleasure to give this talk today. Usually, I talk about how machine learning will revolutionize medicine and healthcare. But for this audience, I decided to revert the two topics and talk about why medicine and healthcare is such a good domain to work for us, the machine learning researchers. And I hope that after the talk today, I will convert many of you to work in this very exciting area of medicine and healthcare. So why is artificial intelligence and machine learning for healthcare different? We all know that machine learning has accomplished wonders on well-posed problems where the notion of a solution is well-defined and the solutions are easily verifiable by a human. The examples abound. They are ranging from image recognition to more recently the successes in protein folding, such as AlphaFold. However, in all these various cases, the problem is very well defined. At times has been a well-defined problem for many years. And when a solution is provided to this set of problems, we can easily identify the solution as being the correct one. However, in medicine and more generally healthcare, this is a lot trickier because the problems are not well posed. And the notion of a solution is often not well defined. And the solutions are often hard to verify by the humans. Let us take the problem of early diagnosis of cancer. It is well known that we can save many lives if we can identify cancer early. But identifying cancer early based on the trajectory of symptoms and potentially changes in the healthcare of a patient is difficult, it's challenging. And at times, even if a solution is provided, it is difficult for the clinicians and medical researchers to verify that. So this presents enormous challenges, but also enormous opportunities. And since we live in the era of COVID-19, this is even more pertinent today. The goal of our lab is to develop cutting-edge machine learning problem formalisms, models and techniques to revolutionize healthcare. But in the process of doing so, we really need to develop new ways of thinking about machine learning. Often we cannot just take an off-the-shelf machine learning method and apply it to a medical problem. We really need to think differently because healthcare obliges us to think in this new way. And in the process, we are developing new machine learning methods. The various things that our lab is trying to achieve by developing AI and machine learning methods range from delivering bespoke medicine. If you wonder what bespoke medicine is and how it is different than precision medicine, please just Google our lab's name and bespoke medicine, and you can read about how bespoke medicine goes beyond precision medicine using machine learning. we can understand the basis and trajectories of health and disease, empower healthcare professionals and patients, inform and improve clinical pathways, better utilize resources and reduce costs, transform population health and public health policy, and enable new discoveries, both clinical discoveries, but also new therapeutics. So our group agenda is to build technology based on machine learning to create such a change in healthcare. And the research of our lab is very diverse. It ranges from automated machine learning to time series forecasting to causal modeling to reinforcement learning and inverse reinforcement learning to machine learning interpretability and explainability, trustworthiness, as well as combination of machine learning and statistics, and much more. If you want to get an idea about what is possible in healthcare and how diverse the technologies are that we need to develop to really change medicine, please take a look at our various papers at NeurIPS 2020, and you can see the range of topics that are pertinent in healthcare. Today, I'm going to briefly talk about three topics that are highlighted here in purple: automated machine learning, causal effect inference, especially automated causal effect inference and causal effect inference over time, and machine learning interpretability and explainability. So let me start with a very simple challenge at the first sight, that of creating clinical analytics. So we have a new data set, and we may want to identify for this data set a set of predictive analytics. The challenge here is that there is no one-size-fits-all solution. And often the clinical researchers or the bioinformatics researchers are not machine learners. So a challenge for them is which machine learning model to choose. And with the machine learning community are very prolific and are advancing the state of the art very rapidly. So it is very complicated for these other communities to really identify what model to choose, what is state of the art, what would perform best for their data set. Related problems when developing such analytics for healthcare are also reproducibility, interpretability, trustworthiness. One solution to address these challenges are to really use automated machine learning to enable us to deal with the wealth of diseases for which we may want to craft clinical scores. And also, since over time, the data that we may acquire may be changing, we may need to train and retrain and maybe even select new models over time. So in this setting, it is really not desirable that you do this by hand, but instead, ideally, you would like to let machine learning itself do the crafting and the selection of methods for a new data set, or potentially for a data set that is changing in terms of its characteristics over time. Like, for example, in COVID-19, where the data is changing over time and the patients that are suffering from COVID-19 may be changing over time as well. Of course, you have heard a lot about AutoML in recent years. But as I'm going to highlight today, AutoML for healthcare is different. It poses different challenges and it needs different types of machine learning methods, thereby again creating a new frontier for machine learning itself. I'm going to highlight the differences as I go along. So how can we really develop risk prediction models at scale? And why would we want to do that? Often when we are going to the clinician, especially the elderly among you, the ones that are a little bit older, you may have your general practitioner or your clinician run a set of risk scores to identify whether you are at risk for a particular type of cancer or a cardiovascular disease or a variety of other diseases on the basis of a few clinical factors. The challenge associated with this is that ideally you would like that for every patient, at the push of a button, many risk scores are computed on the basis of the available data, and we do this at scale, not only for two or three diseases of interest, but rather for many diseases, because there could be patients and subclasses of patients that may have a much higher risk than the average population. The challenge with doing that is that there is really a huge design space for the predictive analytics. And unlike in conventional machine learning predictive methods, we deal with a complex problem because the data on the basis of which we need to learn in medicine may have missing data. So data imputation is extremely important. And also often we may need to learn from a vast amount of clinical factors, but also socio-demographic factors, genetic factors. So we really need to learn in the presence of high dimensionality. So high dimensionality reduction and feature selection are also representing important components. So how can we really build automated machine learning for risk prediction? One way in which we did that a few years back is called autoprognosis. And autoprognosis is a tool for crafting clinical scores at scale. It takes as input clinical data and builds entire pipelines formed of imputation methods, feature processing, classification, and calibration. Depending on the algorithm that is chosen at a particular stage in the pipeline, the algorithms that precede it or follow are different. And there is a vast and very complex problem that we need to solve when addressing this problem because of the large number of algorithms and stages involved. So unlike in a conventional AutoML framework, what we need to deal with here is the increased complexity associated with the methods that are preceding and following it. We are not only needing to issue predictions, but also explanations associated with these predictions. And autoprognosis can do that. In addition, we do not only learn from the data at one particular location, hospital, or country, but we may also want to learn from complementary cohorts, which may be different than the local ones. In that case, we need to look at meta-learning and transfer learning to be able to use the available information from other cohorts to improve the prediction at the current location. And this is work that followed autoprognosis. I'm not going to talk about autoprognosis today. There are many talks from me and my students about autoprognosis online. I'm just going to say today that we already used autoprognosis in many domains. Here are just a few of them: cardiovascular disease, cystic fibrosis, cancer, etc. And most recently, we have also used autoprognosis together with National Health Service, NHS, here in the UK. And I'm going to talk briefly about that at the end of the talk today. But it is a tool and a resource that you can use easily to build analytics for healthcare. But for healthcare, doing just predictions is not enough. We want to go beyond prediction. Often we may need to do time to event analysis, survival analysis. We may need to estimate risk not only from dying or developing a particular disease, but also competing diseases. So competing risks are important. Causal models play an important role because we do not want only to predict, but also to estimate what treatments would be best for a particular patient. And we not only want to learn from cross-sectional static data, but also time series data. So for AutoML in healthcare, we need to go beyond predictions and look at survival models, competing risk causal models, and temporal models. And over the last couple of years, my group has developed technology for all these different areas. And you can take a look at these various works, and talks are available associated with them. Today, I'm going to mainly highlight that of causal models and how we can build AutoML for causal models. What problem do I have in mind? That of estimating on the basis of the available data, what treatment or intervention is best for an individual given their unique characteristic. And this is a challenging problem because we know that treatment effects are often heterogeneous. One set of treatments may not be best for all people. How can we deal with that? One way is to resort to the current golden standard, clinical trials. But randomized controlled trials estimate average treatment effects and have many challenges. Not only that they are targeting the average population, but often clinical trials do not include younger population or elderly patients with comorbidities. And you can see that in COVID-19 trials. often the vaccines have not been enrolling the elderly or the one that have many comorbidities. So advances are needed in terms of improving clinical trials, and machine learning can really offer a lot, both in patient recruitment, dosage estimation, understanding how to recruit patients over time, et cetera, et cetera. I'm not going to talk about this today, but this represents an important frontier, and my group is doing a lot of work on machine learning for improving clinical trials, such that in the future we can estimate much more effectively and much more rapidly the effect of interventions. And if you want to see just one example in this, please take a look at a recent paper, not a machine learning paper. If you want to see the machine learning papers, you can take a look here. But if you want to see the impact that machine learning can do for clinical trials in the era of COVID-19, both for COVID-19 vaccines and treatments, but also for other types of trials, such as clinical trials for cancer that have been interrupted due to the COVID-19, and how machine learning can empower these trials, please take a look at this recent article. What I'm going to talk today is not the clinical trials, but estimating treatment effects at the individualized level from observational data, which are much more scalable and adaptive and are done on the basis of a variety of patients at scale and enable fast deployment and are cost effective, but are also very challenging. Over the last 5-6 years, we have worked extensively in causal effect inference for estimating individualized treatment effects and developed many different methods. As a matter of fact, in a recent article that I have posted on our website, I'm providing for the ones among you that do not know much about this area, a little tutorial with a variety of examples from our work. So please take a look. If you do not know much about this area, but you would like to learn more about it beyond this talk, I would invite you to take a look at this website, which provides a good summary, introductory summary to this work. What is really the idea in causal effect inference? It is to use data sets, observational data sets, where some patients are treated and some patients are untreated, and learn on the basis of this observational data sets, what is the effect of treating a new type of patient, a patient that I've not seen before. And I'm trying to estimate in this way the causal effect of this particular intervention. Here I'm showing the example of a binary treatment, treat or untreat, but by no means the technologies that we have developed are limited to just two treatments. I'm focusing here on just treated or untreated to make the example simple, but the research is not limited to that. A challenge of this work is that if we want to estimate what will be the effect given the unique characteristics of a patient X on the outcome Y, and I would like to estimate the causal effect. So I would need to do that on the basis of an observational data set that does contain only what has happened to the patient given the intervention made. We do not observe counterfactuals. We do not observe what would have happened if the patient was treated in a different way. So this is a much more complex problem than supervised machine learning problems because we do not have explicit labels. We observe only the factuals, but not the counterfactuals. Another challenge associated with causal effect inference is that the data is often biased. Unlike in clinical trials, because we learn on the basis of the observational data and the doctors are not closing their eyes when recommending treatments, we need to deal with the bias associated with the clinical practice. So it is these two problems and a few others, but these are two main problems that we need to address in causal effect inference. And over the past, quite a lot of years, the past many, I would say, years, a variety of technologies have been developed to deal with this problem. Initially in statistics, then in econometrics, and in the last 5 years in machine learning. Our group itself, as I mentioned to you, has developed a lot of technology to deal with this particular problem. So rather than delving in one specific idea and one specific problem, you can take a look at our work in this area, even very recently at NeoRIPS 2020 and AI Stats 2021, we have developed new methods. But rather than presenting you yet a new method, I'd like to talk about how we can use automated machine learning to select the best model for a new data set. Because this is challenging and important given the fact that the wealth of methods is increasing every month. Here you see, for instance, an example of some of the key technologies up to 2019. And what you see is, I indicated with a purple arrow, three technologies that were developed by us around the time, as well as many others from other labs. And again, the challenge is, how can I select a model that is best for a new data set to do causal effect inference? And what I'd like to do is I'd like to select among them the one that would lead to the best outcome. But the challenge here is, unlike in the previous example for clinical analytics, where autoprognosis could rely on cross-validation to select the best method, the challenge is we do not observe counterfactuals. So how can we do cross-validation in that case? How we can compute the error? So in order to automate causal effect inference, you need to think differently. And this is what we have done in ICML 2019. We started to think, how can we validate causal effect models without observing the causal effects, without observing the counterfactuals? What we ideally would like to estimate is the PEHE, or the precision in estimating heterogeneous effects, which is the mean square error of a causal model. And we are estimating that given the individual's features X. How are we going to do that? Because we do not observe counterfactuals. We rely on a seemingly simple idea. And you are all familiar with Taylor series approximation all the way from high school. And in Taylor series approximation, we are approximating the value of a function at a given input X1, given a predictive value, given the fact that we can predict it based on its value at a proximal point, x0. In a similar way, in the case of causal effect inference, in an analogy with the Taylor series approximation, we are inspired by this idea, and we are trying to do something similar. But this time, we are going to estimate the performance of the causal inference model as a which is now a functional, is not just a function, is a functional. So it's a function of a function, is a higher order function of the data generating distribution, P of theta. So what we are going to do is we are going to estimate the unobserved true distribution on the basis of the synthetic distribution with known counterfactuals theta zero. For that, we are going to use functional calculus. We are going to use von Mises expansion. And this will provide a distributional analog of the Taylor expansion. And the difference is that now we are not going to have derivatives like in the Taylor expansions, but rather influence functions. In this way, we can predict the performance of the causal inference model using the influence functions of its loss on a similar synthetic data set. How are we going to estimate such models, causal effect model performance? We are going to synthesize counterfactuals in two steps. First, we are going to do plug-in estimation, where we are going to compute the plug-in PEHE loss for this causal effect model, given the distribution. And then we are going to do bias correction using the influence functions. In this way, even though we observe only factuals, so for instance, in this case, for the red dots are the factuals we are obtaining for the treated patients, and the blue dots are the factuals that you obtain for the untreated patients, we still can estimate and synthesize counterfactuals. What would have happened with the patient which has set feature X if they were treated, even though they were currently not treated, and vice versa? In this way, we can synthesize counterfactual and estimate the treatment effects, the individualized treatment effects, often also called the conditional average treatment effects, conditioned on the features X. So we do that again by doing this first order Taylor approximation, where the inaccessible empirical measure L theta is estimated on the basis of the plug-in synthetic distribution, as well as the influence function, which enables us to do this bias correction. Both of these two terms are accessible empirical measures that we can compute on the basis of the data. And then on the basis of this, we can estimate the inaccessible empirical measure for the counterfactuals. This is explained in a very fast way. You can see more details in our ICML 2019. But what is good about this technology is now we can use automated causal inference. And as new machine learning methods are provided, we can use them to select the best causal model for a new data set. And this is important because, as you see in the experiment we have done here, where we had 77 benchmark data sets from the Atlantic competition, there was no winner for all the different data sets. You see, for instance, the methods in pink here that are coming from our own lab. Some of them, such as NSGP, was doing very well. This is a non-stationary Gaussian process that was developed by us quite a few years back and is doing quite well on many data sets. But still, only 17% of these data sets that this particular method is best. While if we use automated machine learning based on influence functions, 72% of the time we are going to select the best model. So this is an important technology to enable us to select best methods. If you want to read more about this or related methodology for causal effect inference, please take a look at our website dedicated to this particular subtopic. Now, let me say that we would like to ideally move beyond just treatment effects and predictions for static data. We would like to look at time series data. And for that, the problem is challenging, both in terms of selecting the best methods. And you can see some work of last year on AI Stats 2020 on how to do AutoML and Bayesian optimizations in such settings. But most recently, in a recent paper called Clairvoyance, we have tried to develop a whole suite of methods that we have put in the public domain to enable the community to really experiment at scale with time series models. And this goes way beyond existing packages for time series data, which are mainly focused on just time series prediction. Here we also have the ability to do causal effect inference over time, as well as identify how to monitor patients over time and what information we select and when. So if you want to experiment with time series models, not only for prediction and forecasting, but also for monitoring or treatment effects over time, please take a look at this iClear 2021 paper and the associated code. And the reason I think that this is important, it represents a milestone in terms of machine learning for healthcare reproducibility, because often in our area so far, everyone would compare against a different benchmark. So we hope that Clairvoyance can represent an important frontier in reproducibility, and different groups can contribute to Clairvoyance and enhance it such that we can have a framework where pipelines can be built in an easy way for time series prediction. I'm not going to go into the details of the Clairvoyance today, but I'm going to just zoom in a few technologies. One is that of treatment effects over time. The other one will be on monitoring, and the last will be on interpretation. These are all parts of Clairvoyance. The first I'm going to highlight is individualized treatment effects over time. What do I want to do here? Unlike in the previous work that I described, we do not want to identify what treatment is best for the patient at a fixed moment in time, but also look at the trajectory of disease and health of the patient and identify, as the different measurements of these patients are changing, the patient history is changing, what treatments we would like to give to the patient. And also, is this changing over time? When is the ideal moment to start treatment? When shall we stop treatment? And for that, we need to do causal effect inference over time. And very little work in this area existed up till recently. What we want to estimate here is counterfactual outcomes over time. So what type of questions we would like to answer? On the basis of the longitudinal history of the patient, which may include lab tests, vital signs, and all sorts of other measurements, like for instance, for cancer patients, radiological measurements, we would like to estimate and decide treatment plans and what is the optimal time to start treating the patient and what is the best time to stop the treatment, based on the features of the patient, inclusively the longitudinal trajectories. So what we have at our disposal is time-dependent patient features, as well as time-dependent treatment, as well as static patient features, which may include gender, as well as genetic information, et cetera. And this represents the patient history. Again, as in the previous case, we need to estimate what treatments we should give over time and what is the best treatment plan while observing only the factual outcomes. Again, we do not observe counterfactuals. So we observe the history given the decisions or the actions that have been made. We do not observe the counterfactuals. So again, we need to estimate the potential outcomes, and we would like to do that under the planned sequence of future treatments. So we want to compare a large variety of potential treatments and treatments over time and estimate their effect on this individual patient. We are setting that in the context of Neyman-Rubin potential outcome framework, and since we are looking at a longitudinal setting, the work of Robbins and Herna. Two assumptions are usually made in this setting. One is of sequential overlap, the other one is of sequential strong ignorability. I'm going to say that for the sake of strong ignorability or hidden confounders, we have done quite a lot of work in recent times at looking at how can we deal with hidden confounders, especially in the time series setting. And if you are interested to read more about that in an ICML 2020 paper that we call Time Series Deconfounder or the Time Deconfounder, we are addressing this set of challenges. I am not going to discuss about this today. Instead, I'm going to make these two strong assumptions, and I'm going to say that work is underway by us and others to relax these assumptions, and you can take a look at our website. Now, the challenges in using such longitudinal data to estimate individualized treatment effects are the fact that we need to deal with time-dependent confounders, which are biasing the treatment assignment in the observational data set. And what are these time-dependent confounders are the patient covariates that are affected by past treatments, which then influence future treatment and outcomes. And this is introducing bias that we need to learn in the presence of. So this complicates this problem in the longitudinal setting. So how can we handle time-dependent confounding bias? One way in which this can be done is using inverse probability of treatment weighting. And marginal structural models by Robin, Hernan, and others have been a way to look at this particular problem. Actually, a few years back in NeoRIPS 2018, we have enhanced marginal structural models by bringing in ideas from deep learning, from recurrent neural network, such that we can make marginal structural models more powerful and enable them to deal with a variety of time series data, multivariate time series data, and complex time series data. Yet, these ideas based on structural models, marginal structural models and enhancements, are actually at times having limitations. So if you start to do inverse propensity treatment weighting, this is actually creating a pseudo population where the treatment probability no longer depends on the patient covariates. And in this chosen population, the counterfactual estimates are unbiased. However, using this type of inverse propensity of treatment weighting results in high variance due to the extreme weights, which often result in these settings, and also is often numerically unstable when the treatment probability is small. So often these methods, even the more advanced ones, are not doing well for many data sets. So what we did instead is we improved on top of these existing works by learning more powerful representations. And this is what we did in an iClear 2020 paper, where we developed a method called counterfactual recurrent neural network to deal with this issue. So what does counterfactual recurrent network do? It builds treatment invariant representations using domain adversarial training, and it estimates counterfactual trajectories given a variety of treatment plans using sequence-to-sequence architectures. As you can see in here in the lower side of the slide, you can see the diagram associated with the sequence-to-sequence model, and you can see that the encoder, again, is using domain adversarial training to build at each time step a representation of the patient history that is treatment invariant. And this breaks the association between the patient history and the treatment assignment, thereby dealing with bias, and removing this bias from the time-dependent confounders. And then you can see that this representation is passed to the decoder, which is continuously adapted while estimating the outcomes. In this way, we can estimate counterfactuals for a variety of treatment plans. We are training this representation, as I mentioned, using adversarial balance representations, and we use an enhanced ideas based on Ganin's framework, which proposes an adversarial framework for domain adaptation, which involves building a representation which achieves maximum error on a domain classifier and minimum error on an outcome predictor. But in our case, we use domain adversarial training to build representations of the patient history that is both invariant to the treatment given at the time step T and that achieves error estimating the outcome YT. And you can see that in here. Now, how well does this do in practice? For that, we need data sets that enable us, synthetic data sets that enable us to estimate counterfactuals. So we need to have the ground truth. For that, we have built a synthetic data set for cancer based on a very famous Nature paper for cancer, for breast cancer. And what is nice about this synthetic model is that it enables us to control using parameters gamma the amount of time-depending confounder, such that we know how far we can go with confounding and still be able to adjust for it. I'm not going to go into a lot of details, but on the basis of this model, we were able to estimate and validate the accuracy of the treatment plan, the fact that we can identify indeed correctly the treatment plans. And you can see that the counterfactual recurrent neural network, CRN, does a lot better than our previous recurrent marginal structural model and the conventional marginal structural models, which are the workhorse in this area. You can see that the performance is significantly improved, even given significant bias. Moreover, we can also estimate not only what treatment we should use, but also the timing of when the treatment should be given or discontinued. This is representing an important component of the clairvoyance framework. But also, we would like to estimate not only the effects of treatments and treatments over time. Patients with cancer need to come back and be seen by the clinicians over time. So we need to see if the cancer has spread or the patient is doing well and doesn't have recurrence. For that, we need to do active sensing. And here it is where it is useful to be not only a machine learner, but also a former signal processing researcher, because we combine ideas from active sensing with ideas from deep learning to enable to determine us when shall we acquire information again, when shall we screen the patient again, and what information we should acquire about him, what type of test we should be giving to estimate the subsequent trajectory of disease and as well as the treatments of the patient. When should the patient come next? Should it come like currently? Often patients are required to come back after a fixed number of months, Or can we move to an individualized screening and monitoring setting where we can identify that a particular patient may need to come faster or another patient may need to come much later or never because we are sure that they will progress in a disease-free way. This enables us to determine value of information and value of information over time for a specific patient. If you are interested about that, please take a look at our papers dedicated to this. Now, let me move into the last part of this talk, which talks about interpretability, because in healthcare, we cannot only just issue predictions and estimates of treatment effects. We also need to identify and understand why a particular model and predictive model has worked well, thereby having interpretability. We also need trustworthiness. We need to know when we are confident in our predictions and when we are not, as well as explainability. Let me move into interpretability first. So often we have black box models that may result in a very good predictive performance. For instance, we can use autoprognosis for COVID-19, and we may predict that a particular patient, given their unique characteristics, have a high chance of dying from COVID-19. But why is that? We would like to X-ray the black box model. We would like to understand the black box model. And one way in which we can do that is by a technology called inference, which we have developed a few years back, which is identifying at the individual level what features were important for the black box model when looking at this particular individual. So you can plug in any black box model you like and X-ray it using inference. This could be a static model or even a dynamic model. How does inference work? In a very simple way. It learns using reinforcement learning. The idea is that we make observations about patient features, and on the basis of this, we select actions, which in this case are the subset of features which were important for the black box model in order to issue their predictions. And then we determine the rewards for these actions, which are how well could the method, the black box model issue predictions if these features were indeed for this individual exposed to the black box model or not. So we are ultimately learning a policy that maximizes the rewards given the observations, the patient features. And for that, we use a very simple reinforcement learning framework, an actor-critic framework. So inference take a black box model, for instance, a neural network, and is estimating using an actor, which selects the features using an actor network, a selector network, that determines which features should be provided to the black box model to issue their prediction. So the selector network takes patients and outputs vectors of selection probabilities of feature importance. Then the critic takes these features and uses them to issue predictions, and the error between the predictor using only these features versus the predictor using all the features, that error in prediction is the critic's feedback to the actor. One advantage of inference as opposed to many other models such as LIME, Learning to Explain, and SHAP, is that not only is model independent and provides individualized feature importance, which is also true for LIME or Learning to Explain, but there is one more advantage besides the ease of training. The fact that we are able to discover the number of relevant features as well. So unlike in these other cases where we need to pre-specify a number of features that are important, inference is able to learn that, for instance, for Anne, there are 3 features that are important, and for Bob, there are 5. And which ones are those? So should we declare success? Well, for healthcare, this is not enough. Just understanding feature importance, individualized feature importance, looking at statistical interactions is not enough. We need transparent risk equations associated with predictions in order to have approval in clinical practice. And we need to move beyond model explainability, beyond model interpretability into explainability. So can we have all of this? And the answer is yes. In 2019, we made the first advancement in this area, and later in NeurIPS 2020, we advanced on top of this work. But let me describe, in view of time, just the initial idea, which is based on demystifying any black box model using symbolic metamodels. We can take a black box model and X-ray it using symbolic metamodels that are then explained using white box transparent model. What are metamodels? Metamodels are models of models, and symbolic metamodels output transparent functions describing the prediction of a black box model. And the advantage of the metamodels are that we need only query access to the trained black box model. We do not need to know the training set, and we do not need to have access to the black box model that can remain intellectual property of the data and of the modeler. Then, how does symbolic metamodel work? We are allowing the user of the metamodel, so in this case, maybe clinicians, to select what type of white box models they want. And then symbolic metamodels are projecting the black box models, such as neural networks, which are uninterpretable, into the user space that is selected by the user. How are we going to be able to create these projections? By an insight on the basis of the Kolmogorov-Arnold theorem, which tells us that any multivariate continuous function can be written as a composition of finite compositions of univariate continuous functions. And in this way, we can project this black box model into a selected space of interpretable white box basic functions. Then we can identify the parameters and hyperparameters of these white box functions that are best approximating the black box model. So we learn the parameters theta of the white box models J, and through hyperparameter optimization, we identify how close we can approximate the black box model F. What type of white box models? One particular class is Meyer G functions. I'm not going to go in the details of Meyer G functions, but again, it helps that I was in a past time a communications researcher, because Meyer G functions are very important in communication systems. But for the sake of this discussion, the reason they are very good is because they are very general classes of functions that are parameterizable, and for different sets of parameters yield many familiar functions, many interpretable familiar functions. So then what we can do is we can identify what is the closest white box model associated with the black box model. And we can do that in a very simple way by doing a simple gradient descent algorithm. So in a similar way in which we learn the parameters of neural network using simple gradient descent, in a similar way, we can learn the parameters of Meyer G functions using gradient descent, which can be done very fast, learn how we can compose metamodels that best approximate the black box model. In this way, we are able to turn black box models using white box model into interpretable predictions. And what you can see is that then these metamodels can replace the black box models. So for instance, they can replace the autoprognosis framework and yield very high predictive performance, much better than often statistical models do, at a very limited loss as opposed to the black box models. So the black box model is still needed to guide our identification of the metamodels, white box models. But after we have these metamodels, we no longer need the original black box model. We can discard it and issue predictions on the basis of these interpretable metamodels. You can read more about this at our NeurIPS 2019 and our NeurIPS 2020 work. Also in this way, we are able to learn individual level feature importance. And this goes beyond current methods for feature importance, because we don't just say, age and gender is important, but also we are able to understand and do sensitivity analysis and be able to understand, for instance, how age is changing, what will be the effect on the prediction given the other variables. In this way, we move beyond interpretability into explainability because we are able to use such metamodels to provide different explanations to clinicians, researchers, and patients. And we can use these metamodels to identify treatments, do hypothesis induction by using the metamodels in the forward use, or we can identify using these metamodels what type of policies for screening or for dosage recommendation we can use in the backwards setting. If you want to read more and listen more to this work, I invite you to take a look at a Turing talk that I gave just before the pandemic really started in the UK. In a Turing talk, you can take a look and see some of the work we have done in this area, and you can see a discussion with clinicians about this topic. Finally, I'd like to say that we don't want to issue only predictions. We also want to have trustworthiness associated with this prediction. And for that, we need to move beyond just Bayesian approaches based on Monte Carlo dropout or deep ensembles. We need to have post hoc methods, which are operating not like, for instance, Monte Carlo dropout and variational inference at training time, but rather after a model has been trained. We need to identify how well does it do. And also it's not sufficient to just have Bayesian credible intervals. Often for medicine, we need true coverage guarantees. So for that, we have developed recent technologies for both the static setting, discriminative jackknife, as well as dynamic setting, where we look again at the use of influence functions, but in a different setting than the one that I described here, to identify frequentist uncertainty estimates for recurrent neural networks. This enables us to take an already trained model and identify credible coverage for these different models in a post hoc fashion. If you wonder whether these technologies can play a role in the era of COVID-19, the answer is yes. Early in this pandemic, I have written a position paper in which I identify 5 different areas in which machine learning can play a role in this pandemic. And since then, in the last 1 year, we have worked on all these 5 different topics together with a variety of partners, both pharma partners, individual organizations, as well as the NHS, to really use machine learning to address these various topics, ranging from limited resources to clinical trials in the era of COVID-19, to informing policies and improving collaborations across countries, to managing uncertainty. If you want to see what we have done with machine learning to empower a variety of stakeholders in COVID-19, please take a look to our website dedicated to COVID-19 projects. And you can read this particular work, which since then appeared in the Machine Learning Journal. What we have done with NHS was early in the pandemic, we used autoprognosis to help hospitals plan better their resources in the era of COVID-19, identify beds as well as estimate how many beds and ventilators may be needed in the short run and in the long run. And we have built demonstrators of these technologies across the UK. Again, more about this in a recent machine learning paper. Finally, I hope I convinced you that machine learning for healthcare is not only powerful, but also requires a new way of thinking than conventional machine learning. And it can empower and really make a difference in terms of both clinical practice, enable new discoveries, and new therapeutics. If you are interested in this area, I would like to say that we are hiring brilliant students and postdocs. And actually, I'm very fortunate to have in an audience a brilliant former student and postdoc, Professor Yannis Andriopoulos from UCL, who is in the audience. So I really hope I convince more of you to join our lab. If so, please write to us. And if you are interested to learn more about this topic, we also have an engagement session for young researchers or old researchers alike who may be interested in healthcare. and machine learning for healthcare in particular. So join us if you are interested in this engagement session and learn more about our work as well as what we can do together to transform healthcare using machine learning. Thank you.
Mihaela, thank you so much. This was a fantastic talk. I will now stop the recording and we can start the Q&A.
Thank you so much.